It's a way of life in New York that organized crime has under their control union officials. They are just a tool to make money. By having control over the union, you exercise control over the entire industry. I don't just mean truck drivers. I mean waitresses, waiters, bartenders, construction workers. Every form of labor is totally controlled by organized crime in the New York metropolitan area. And I mean the mafia by organized crime.
In the early years of this century, the right of American workers to belong to unions was won only after long and violent strikes. The robber barons of American industry banned unions from their factories. Whenever workers went on strike, employers hired gangs of thugs or goons to crush them. The unions decided to fight violence with violence by hiring gangsters.
Well, we'd go to these strikes and you'd fight. And they had picket lines, and at that time you could fight, you know, and the cops wouldn't do nothing. And then the parking lots, like I say, I threw acid on cars. The transportation driver, same thing. We'd ruin their cars, put sugar in, or, you know, whatever, trucks, you know. That's it. I mean, I did a lot of work for them, you know, when I was a kid.
In the frequent strikes of the 1920s, protecting union pickets became a profitable business for gangsters like Jimmy Fratiano.
The first one, the Secretary Treasurer called me and said, Jimmy, bring me 10 guys, you know. So I would pay him $5 a piece. I would get $15 for every person. Now, for me, I'd get 50 a day. For on the picket line. I would get 15 for each one I had. So I'd give them $5 and I'd keep 10. So other guys would do the same thing from their neighborhood, you know, would bring 10. Well, maybe we'd have 100, 150 guys, tough guys. You know, guys that could handle their dukes, see? And that's the way they used to work it in them days. You would hire. I would bring kids, you know, guys 18, 19 years old. And that's the way it worked.
Strikes turned into bloody wars as the heavies on both sides battled it out. These strikes only served to strengthen the links between the gangsters and the unions.
And how did this affect the growth of the union?
Well, they'd win the strike. You know what I mean? And eventually that the more members they got. But they was always did good for the working class. You know, they always got them good money and got them raises. Well, like I say, that the mob started these unions from the ground floor in the 20s.
It was on the waterfront of New York that the mob first took over a major union. The entire port could be brought to a standstill by the International Longshoremen's Association, the ILA, to which all dockers belonged. Through the shape-up, the mob ruled every longshoreman. When a ship came in, longshoremen seeking work had to shape up by forming a crowd around a hiring boss who had the sole power to hire labor on his pier. Anyone who wanted to work had to hand over part of his pay as a kickback to the hiring boss. The mob further exploited the longshoremen with their gambling and money-lending rackets. The mob ruled through violence and murder. The men who challenged them could end up in the river. Sometimes the victims were rival gangsters. Usually they were longshoremen who dared to speak out against the mobsters who ran the union.
There was a lot of rough stuff going on. Mike Brogan was found dead in the river during the middle of our campaign. And newspapers come up and I told them he was probably killed down there.
Murdered?
Huh? Murdered. And the detectives come up, wanted to know how the hell I knew that he was murdered. I said, the same way that you said it was accidental. How the hell do you know it was accidental? I still say he was murdered. After 30 years working on a waterfront, you just don't fall in a river. You know your way around.
Johnny Dwyer became a longshoreman in 1937. His fight against the mob inspired the film On the Waterfront and the character played by Marlon Brando. Dwyer led the campaign to rid the union of its gangster bosses.
They represented the whole waterfront. What they said, whatever came out of 14th Street, which was the ILA headquarters, that was it. That was the law. And for years and years, nobody dared question what they said, even when they told you it could only get a nickel raise.
The union's bosses operated behind a front of respectability.
They were the three-piece suit criminals, I would call them. You know, you would never take them for criminals because it was all done in a back room. Nothing done. If they wanted to beat somebody up, they sent somebody else down to do it.
In the Brooklyn section of New York, Anthony Anastasia, Tough Tony, was the boss of the ILA. His power came not from his union rank, but from his high standing in the mafia. His rackets were often investigated, but he always came out proclaiming his innocence.
They give you a bad time in there.
There was the most bunch of gentlemen I ever met in my life.
We know you have a right to refuse to sign, Tony, but we're wondering the reason.
You have a right to tell us what you said legally.
Believe me sincere. Believe me sincere. They treat me as a gentleman, and I answer every question as a gentleman to them.
Have you been asked to come back again?
No, sir. No?
Tony, you said some things about the investigation when you went in. Why have you changed your mind? Now you won't talk about it.
You see, when a man is not stealing, a man is not taking no kickback, a man is not committing a crime and never got to worry about.
Tough Tony was a captain in the mafia family led by his notorious brother Albert. For 30 years, Albert Anastasia was the mafia's most ruthless enforcer, the head of its assassination squad, Murder Incorporated. Albert would come to a fitting end, shot with such force that he was blown out of a barber's chair. The mafia dons who ordered his death simply took over his rackets, but the continuing violence led to demands from press and public to clean up the waterfront. Now the longshoremen dared to protest against the mob's control over their livelihoods. They went on strike, not against the employers, but against their own union. Even Tough Tony Anastasia had to take shelter in the middle of his band of supporters. The longshoremen who ridiculed Tough Tony protested that the union bosses were taking bribes from the employers to keep longshoremen's wages low. They tried to get Tony voted out of the leadership and clear the waterfront of his mafia heavies. The rebels won so much support that they finally forced New York's politicians to move against the mob in the union. In 1953, a waterfront commission was set up to govern the port of New York. The commission was given the power to license anyone who worked on the waterfront and to expel crooked union officials from the piers. One of its first moves was to abolish the shape-up and end the mob's control over who got work. Now jobs were handed out in hiring halls by the commission's own officials. At last, longshoremen had something to smile about. They no longer had to pay kickbacks to get work, and their wages rose. It looked as if the commission really could clean up the port. But as fast as it threw mobsters off the waterfront in New York, the mobsters found other ports to exploit. In the 1960s, the ports of Florida began to boom. Miami had been a small harbor for local Caribbean shipping until 1964, when a huge new facility opened on Dodge Island, purpose-built for ocean-going vessels.